Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues, as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven, when they heard this sound. A crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They've had too much wine." And Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd, "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will turn to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved."
Good morning. Today I want to talk about time and timing, or perhaps more accurately, both. On this Pentecost Sunday, this Whit Sunday, I want to set some pillars in your life and mine, so that we can have them for today and for the months and perhaps the years ahead that we can refer back to. The first thing I want to point out is that God has his time. I want you to note that there is nothing that the disciples and the apostles could have done to have changed this time, this day of Pentecost, when the Spirit came. No ritual that they could have performed, no rite, no sermon, no earnest praying, fasting, or lack of it could have changed this time. It was God's appointed time. There are some things that we cannot change, and there are some things that we can change. In 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9, Peter says, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of righteousness. So then, dear friends, since you're looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless and blameless and at peace with him." So, there are some things that we can change. We are told that we can hasten the return of the Lord Jesus. But this day, this Pentecost, this first Pentecost, nothing could have changed when that was going to happen. There are appointed times, and while we're discussing this, there are appointed places and appointed means by which we can surround ourselves with the things of God and learn more about him and his sovereign will. We have to note, and we have to note well, that within the pages of Scripture, there's no record of celebrating Pentecost or Whit Sunday as a memorial. We celebrate Mother's Day and Father's Day. And on one trip that I had to see the family in Australia, my wife and I went along to a local school to celebrate Grandfather's Day, or Grandparents' Day as it was. I think it was then that one of the grandchildren said, "How come there isn't a Children's Day?" And received the quick answer, "That's because every day is Children's Day." There is no record that the disciples in the book of Acts celebrated the moving, their moving in the Spirit, because every day was the Spirit's day. They had no time for ritual or remembering, because they were living it, living in a time of radical reality, moving in the might of the Spirit and not meandering in the memories and nostalgia of distant bygone days. There were no comments of, "Do you remember that fantastic day 2 or 3 years ago when the Spirit came?" That didn't happen. The church was moving, compelled by the love of God and propelled by the Spirit's breath. Continuing, that day, that Pentecost day, did not arrive without the events of the previous days. There were 2 months, 50 days, that's what Pentecost means, that turned their lives upside down. These group of men and women had experienced the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. They had experienced the reality that without Christ life is hopeless, and they were without hope. Before ever Pentecost had come upon any man or woman, they must have had to experience the reality of John 15:5. Jesus said, "I am the vine and you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing." Now, this word "nothing" in John 5:15 is literally translated as "not one thing." So you see, I'm not asking, do you believe in Jesus? I'm asking, have you died to the old life? Do you realize that without him you can do nothing? We're invited to walk the way of the cross, but the way of the cross always leads to the cross. In the time of Jesus, if you saw someone carrying a cross, you knew something for certain. They weren't coming back. For any of us to be made alive by the Spirit, we must first die to the old life. And I commend to you at this point a book by a man called Roy Hessian called The Calvary Road. We're not only called to carry our cross, but to choose it. Again, they had witnessed the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. They were men and women with a new life within them. Paul writes in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." Jim Elliot, a missionary who was killed in Ecuador, was preaching the gospel, wrote this quote over his life: "Father, make me a crisis man. Bring those I contact to decision. Let me not be a milepost on a single road. Make me a fork that men must turn one way or another on facing Christ in me." In addition, they had been taught by the Lord Jesus Christ himself over a period of 40 days. Acts chapter 1 and verse 3 says, "After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: 'Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about.'" He not only taught them, but he also commanded them. So this people that gathered were not only people who were taught, but they were people who were obedient to what they were taught. They were obedient to the words of Jesus. I want us to note that from the day of the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he left this earth, to the coming of the Holy Spirit to this planet, was just 10 days. The 10 days of lockdown. Not to make the coming of the Spirit happen, but rather for them to be ready for him when he came. I also need to point out that doctrine is not dynamic. People, please, don't think that knowing the right things is enough. It is not enough and never will be. It is the Spirit's presence in our lives as we obey that is dynamic. Thirdly, I want you to notice that which seems so obvious, that the Holy Spirit fell on people. The Holy Spirit didn't fall on plans or projects. God is not looking for better plans or better projects. God is looking for better people. It is a time for us to be better people. I want you to notice that when the Spirit came, he came on all the people gathered in that upper room. No exceptions. It is my belief that the people that were there were dead people. They were resurrected people living in this new life. They were taught people. They were obedient people. These were the people on whom the Spirit fell. He could not, and he would not, and he will not fall on anyone other than this kind of person. It was a personal experience for each of those individuals, but it was also a corporate experience for them as a whole. Your personal life matters. Your personal life either helps or hinders, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon you will also affect the body of Christ gathered. Your life matters. Fourthly, it was a time of change. The church, once the Spirit came, would never be the same again. It would never be hiding in an upper room. It would never be collapsing in upon itself. The experience of the Holy Spirit falling upon the church drove them out of the door into a world full of problems, darkness, and confusion. There is nothing easy here for a church under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. There was total disruption from a gathering of 120 Jewish disciples of Jesus to a gathering of over 3,000 culturally different people. Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. Please, don't ask Spirit to come if you want to stay the same. And finally, it was an unexpected time. They were sitting with their eyes open. It was not the time of prayer as we perhaps would understand prayer. It was not a time of worship as perhaps we would understand worship. It was more a time of fellowship and obedience to the Word of God. They were sitting, not the usual position of prayer in the New Testament. Their eyes were open, for they saw the flames of fire on each of their heads. But please notice this, the only flame that they did not see was the flame on their own head. How humbling is that? This did not happen just to the apostles, Peter, James and John, but to the other nine as well. It happened to Mary, the mother of Jesus, but not just Mary, but to all who had gathered there. There is no mention in the Word of God that one of the apostles or disciples said, "This is the day, this is what we've been waiting for, it's all over now." The word says in chapter 1, verse 1 of Acts, "In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach. What Jesus began is now continued. Not only was God with his people, but God was in his people." And so just two questions from me. Are you willing for this? Are you willing for the Spirit to come and to disrupt your life as an individual? And as we sit perhaps later today in our homes because of the situation that we are in, is the church willing for this? Is the church willing for the Lord Jesus through his Spirit to disrupt the church and set all of what we desire on fire for him? It is my hope that we will say yes to those questions. May God bless you. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that we have this day to stop and to pause. But Father God, please do not make today just a memorial day when we pause for a few moments and forget that this is a day of continuing blessing if we walk in the Holy Spirit of God. We ask that, Father God, as you look upon us as individuals and look upon us in our local church and look upon us as a nation and as part of the world, that you would fulfill your promise when you said, I will build my church. And Father God, we ask that you would work within us so that our person and our character might be changed, that you, by your Spirit, would make us better people. And that, Lord, you would launch us by your Spirit into a world that needs to hear in power the word of God. Bless your church, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. There I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Your grace abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand would be my guide. Feed me fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail and you won't start now.
As your love in wave after wave crashes over me, crashes over me.
Thanks for watching all. I hope you enjoyed the video. If so, consider subscribing so that you'll be notified when we add new videos. Thank you. God bless. Take care. Bye.